Take note in your bulletin a couple things. One, we want to thank everybody for the beautiful flowers, the hydrangeas and lilies. And you can check out in the bulletin all those given in memory and honor of precious loved ones. So check that out. And also, you might find an envelope in your bulletin. That's for our Annie Armstrong, the North American Mission Offering. So if you'd like to share in that, just drop that in the offering plate. And the offering plate's at the door. In addition to that, if you have any prayer requests, we want to lift you up and support you. Or any other way we can help, or if you'd like to receive information from the church, just fill that out and drop it in one of those plates, and we will lift you up. And check out in there. There's a couple great Bible studies taking place in addition to our normal Sunday morning Bible studies. And on Sunday morning, we've got a great class, co-ed class in here. And then we've begun a new class in Fellowship Hall and Hope for the Hurting. And so if you'd like to join us, you don't have a class, that'll take place at 10 o'clock on Sunday mornings in the Fellowship Hall. And then on Wednesday nights, we're looking through the book of Exodus. And then also on Sunday nights at 5, we're doing also the Hope for the Hurting. So if you'd like to be a part of that, and that'll take place. And then we've got a new Bible study coming up on Sunday nights coming soon. All right. And then also, I knew there was something else today. And see on the big screen there, Colby and Madeline are here today, and they're going to dedicate their little son, Truman, so we'll celebrate that. So a lot to celebrate on Easter Sunday, and most of all, we're thrilled that you're here. Let's go to the Lord in prayer and thank Him for the day and ask Him to bless us as we celebrate His gift, and we seek to share that gift with everyone we meet. Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank You for the joy of already being together as a church family this morning earlier and sharing in the Lord's Supper and remembering Your sacrifice on the cross for each and every one of us, and just the joy of fellowshipping together and celebrating this day that we remember that You have risen and that You've overcome death and You've given life to us, not just in heaven, but right here and right now. Bless us today as we sing Your praises, we listen to the wonderful music, and as we look at Your Word, and as we celebrate with this young family as they dedicate their child to You, Lord. We love You. We know that You meet our every need, and we know that if we turn to You, we can find all that we desire, Lord. So turn our hearts towards You, and let us respond. We love You, Lord, and we thank You for Your gift of Jesus. In Christ's precious name we pray. Amen. All right, we'll begin our call to worship. Miss Emily's going to come and lead us. Grab your hymnals, 160.
Good morning. He is risen.
He's risen indeed.
Yes. All right, we're going to stand and sing number 160, Low in the Grave He Lay. From the grave He arose with a mighty triumph o'er His foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and He lives forever with His saints to reign. He arose, hallelujah, Christ arose. Verse 2. The grave He arose with a mighty triumph o'er His foes. He arose a victor from the dark domain, and He lives forever with His saints to reign. He arose, hallelujah, Christ arose. Verse 3. The grave He arose with a mighty triumph for His foes. He arose a victor
Amen. The dedication.
Seated. All right, we're blessed to have a young couple with us. The Cannons, if y'all want to come on up. We're blessed to have Colby and Madeline and Truman. Y'all come on up, stand there in the center. All right. Hey, buddy. Y'all doing all right? All right. We are thrilled to have them come. And I want to read to you two little brief passages of Scripture. One is to y'all. This is Moses speaking in Deuteronomy 6, 4 through 7. And said, "Hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one Lord, and you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, and with all your might. And these words which I command you this day shall be upon your heart, and you shall teach them diligently to your children. You shall talk to them when you sit in your house, when you walk on the way, when you lie down, and when you rise up." And that's God's command to you. But God also asked for us. This scripture is for you, church family. It says, "And he took a child, Jesus, and put it in the midst of them. And taking them in his arms, he said to them, 'Whoever receives one such child in my name receives me. And whoever receives me receives not me, but him who sent me.'" So it's our job to receive and to love this little one. Right, Truman? All right. He's doing good. All right. Now, parents, being a parent's an awesome responsibility. I think by now you figured that out. But it's also a wonderful joy, isn't it? It is. And in presenting your child today to the Lord, do you promise a dependence upon God's grace and upon partnership with our church here at Blue Ridge to teach Truman the truths of Christian faith, to set a Christian example before him, and to discipline in the Lord, and to encourage him to accept Christ as his Savior under the guidance of the Holy Spirit? Will you seek to do that? We do. All right. And do you, Blue Ridge Baptist Church, do you as members of the church promise to join Madeline and Colby in teaching and training little Truman that he may be led in due time to trust Christ as Savior, to confess him in baptism and church membership? And if you accept this responsibility and you promise to pray for them and babysit for them, will you join in standing? All right, and that's all of us, and we will pray for you. In fact, why don't we have a word of prayer for you, okay? Dear Lord, we ask you to bless this precious couple. Help them to know our love for them, and help them to know that you love them and have great plans for them in the days ahead, and long to be with them and develop little Truman to know all that you want him to desire, Lord, to live a full, abundant, and joyful life. And we ask you to bless Madeline and Colby, give them grace and strength in days ahead, and we ask you to bless little Truman. In Christ's precious name we pray. Amen. Amen. Well, God bless you all. We're very happy for you. Congratulations, and good to see you, buddy. God bless you. All right, thank you all. Thank you so much. Yes.
All right, you may stand back up. We're going to sing hymn 177. There's something about that name. Yeah. We're going to sing it two times through. Savior, Jesus, friend. again.
Jesus, 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 there's just something about that name. Master, Savior, Jesus, like the fragrance after the rain.
All right, you may be seated.
Good morning, church family. I don't know about you, but if you were standing up here, you would see the most beautiful group of people in this whole world. Y'all are just look good this morning. And we're so thankful that you're here. And as you see, if you missed this morning, we have an addition to our group today. And let me tell you, she adds to it. And so you will find out here just a second. You will be very impressed. Thank you, Emily, for joining us this morning. We're going to wait for Mr. Buddy.
Well, I'm old and slow.
We like old and slow.
All right. Which one are we doing first?
When he was on the cross.
I'm not on an ego trip, I'm nothing on my own. I make mistakes, I often slip, just common flesh and bone. But I'll prove someday just why I say I'm of a special kind. For when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. For he knew me, yet he loved me. He whose glory makes the heavens shine. So unworthy of such mercy, yet when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. The look of love was on his face, and thorns were on his head. His blood fell on the scarlet robe and stained the crimson red. Though his eyes were on the crowd that day, he looked ahead in time. For when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. For he knew me, yet he loved me. He whose glory makes the heavens shine. So unworthy of such mercy, yet when he was on the cross, I was on his mind.
he knew me, yet he loved me. He whose glory makes the heavens shine, so unworthy of such mercy. Yet when he was on the cross, I was on his mind. Yet when he was on the cross, I was on his mind.
Straight in. Think how Jesus died and for my sins was crucified. Oh, a love such as this I just can't comprehend. And then I think how he must feel to have suffered through that ordeal, yet his love has been rejected by so many through the years. I wonder if he ever cries when he thinks of how he bled and died. Does the memory remain? Can he still feel the pain of sin and shame he bore for me? And every time he sees his scars, does it bring a tear into his eyes? When many never serve him, not caring how he loved them, I wonder, does it make him cry? When I think about the blood that Jesus shed through love and the pain that he suffered in dying agony. Yet in the midst of all his grief, he had mercy on one thief who simply asked for mercy, and salvation he received. I wonder if he ever cries when he thinks of how he bled and died. Does the memory remain? Can he still feel the pain of sin and shame he bore for me? And every time he sees his scars, does it bring a tear into his eyes? Does the memory remain?
How he loved me.
I wonder if it makes him cry. When many never serve him, not caring how he loves them, I wonder if it makes him cry.
Thank you for coming up.
Okay, we can stand for hymn number 159. This is our fellowship hymn, Christ the Lord is Risen Today, number 159. Christ the Lord is risen today, alleluia. Sons of men and angels say, alleluia. Raise your joys and triumphs high, alleluia. Sing ye heavens and earth reply, alleluia. Okay, greet those around you. Wave to them this morning.
Love's redeeming work is done, alleluia. Fought the fight, the battle won, alleluia. Death in vain forbids him rise, alleluia. Christ has opened paradise, alleluia.
Verse 4.
Soar we now where Christ has led, alleluia. Following our exalted head, alleluia. Made him like him, we rise, alleluia. Ours across the grave, the
all right, next is our offertory hymn. It is 282, Living for Jesus, hymn number 282. We have plates at the side if you'd like to drop your offering in the plates up at the side, at the front. last verse. Living for Jesus through our little while, my dearest treasure, the light of his smile. Seeking the lost ones, he died to redeem, bringing the weary to find rest in him. Oh, Jesus.
All right, at this time, David Funches, will you come and lead us in a word of prayer, dedication for our offering?
Not only for us here, but for the world wide, and just help us to know your plan here.
Robert, that was tremendous. And you know, he's only been playing for 3 months. And no, that is fantastic. Thank you so much for being with us. That was beautiful. All right. And then we're blessed today to have Clarence Mann going to come sing for us. And Clarence, I want you and Janet to know that we keep you in our prayers. And very much so. Last year, Janet got a lung transplant and everything. I think it's still going good, aren't they? Going well. That's great. Thank you, Clarence. God bless you. All right. Any of the kiddos like to come up front? All right. We're going to answer two questions this morning with the children, two key questions. All right. First, we'll do our riddles, and we'll answer the two questions. And if you'd like to pick up your flowers today, hydrangeas here. We've got lilies in different places up there and at the foot of the cross, too. All right, y'all, come on over here. Just a minute. All right, y'all ready for your riddles? All right. Here we go. All right, y'all can join in this, too. All right, if a rooster laid an egg on top of a hill, which direction would it roll down? This is a mathematical one. If a rooster laid an egg on top of a hill, which direction would it roll down? It would roll downhill. That's right. But actually, it wouldn't roll anywhere because roosters don't lay eggs. So, oh, bad, bad. All right, here's one even worse. What do you call an Easter bunny after Easter? A rabbit? Okay. What do you call an Easter bunny after Easter? No, you call it tired. Tired. All right. Let's see if I get one bad. I like this one anyway. This is the calendar one. Let's see if you get this. Does February like March? This is a rumor. Does February like March?
No.
No, you're right. February doesn't, but April, May. All right. Now, two questions here, two key questions, deep spiritual significance. Okay, the first question is this, and that is, what color is Avery's cast?
White.
What is it? What color is Avery's cast? I mean, Evelyn's cast. Avery doesn't have a cast. I'm a prophet. No, I'm not. Don't do that. What color is Evelyn's cast? What color is it, sweetie?
It's a splendid, but it's a brown and white.
Brown and white. All right. All right. Inquiring minds wanted to know. All right. All right. The other question simply is, who is Jesus? On Easter, we need to find out who Jesus is. Who is Jesus? He's the Son of God. That's right. He's also the one who died for us on the cross. And today we celebrate that he did what? And he rose from the grave 3 days later. And he lives. And he lives forever. And we can live with him if we know Jesus as our Lord and Savior. All right. All right. Now, y'all, if y'all promise to be nice, Miss Jackie will take you on out to Children's Church. All right. Y'all be good. All right. Everybody grab your Bibles. We're going to look at the Paul's Easter story. And that's found in 1 Corinthians chapter 15. There we go. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 5. We're going to look at Paul's Easter story. And there we go. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 5. Verses 3 through 11. I'll be here in a minute. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 3 through 11. This is Paul's Easter story. He says, What I received, I passed on to you as of first importance, that Christ died for our sins according to Scripture, that he was buried, that he was raised on the third day according to Scriptures, and that he appeared to Peter, and then to the 12, and after that he appeared to more than 500 of the brothers at the same time, most of whom are still living, though some have fallen asleep. Then he appeared to James, and then to all the apostles, and last of all he appeared to me also, to one abnormally born. For I am least of the apostles and do not even deserve to be called an apostle because I persecuted the church of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am. And his grace to me was not without effect. No, I worked harder than all of them. Yet not I, but the grace of God was with me. Whether then it was I or they, this is what we preach. And this is what you believed. Paul starts off by saying in verse 3, this is of first importance. It is first importance. Nothing is more important than the Easter story. I was listening to Billy Graham the other day, and this is what he said about Easter. He says, the resurrection of Christ changed midnight of the bereaved into sunrise of reunion. It changed the midnight of disappointment into the sunrise of joy. It changed the midnight of fear to the sunrise of peace. Easter changes everything. And it is, as Paul says, of first importance. And as we're looking at today, Easter means what? Easter means, as we've been talking about the last few weeks, Easter means victory. It means several things. One, Easter was, first of all, God's plan. That's what it says in verse 3 and 4. It was God's plan. His plan was to have Jesus come, live among us, share the good news of God, and die on the cross for our sins, be buried, and then 3 days later, rise from the dead. That's what he says. He died for our sins according to Scripture, and that he was raised on the third day according to Scripture. That is God's plan for us. And God's plan was to redeem us, to forgive us, to bring us eternal life, and to bring us victory. And it was all in accordance with God's Scripture. It was not some accident that Christ just kind of fell into. It was God's plan from the beginning of time. In fact, I was looking to one of my favorite passages in the book of Isaiah. In Isaiah chapter 53, verses 3 through 11. If you look at Isaiah 53, all the way in the Old Testament, Isaiah, Jeremiah, Ezekiel, Daniel, Isaiah 53. If you look at verses 3 through 11, hundreds of years before the coming of Jesus, what did it say? It says, talking about Jesus, it says he was despised and rejected by men. Jesus was a man of sorrows, familiar with suffering, like one from whom men hide their faces. He was despised and we esteemed him not. Verse 4 says, surely he took up our infirmities and carried our sorrows. Yet we considered him stricken by God, smitten by him and afflicted. That's what the religious leaders thought. They thought he got what he deserved. But he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities, and the punishment that brought us peace was upon him. By his wounds we are healed. He says, we are all like sheep. We've gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way, and the Lord laid on him the iniquity of us all. It was God's plan. He was oppressed and afflicted, yet he did not open his mouth. He was led like a lamb to the slaughter. As a sheep before his shearers is silent, so he did not open his mouth. That was Jesus all the way. He did not protest. He did not complain. He didn't ask for a lawyer. He walked willingly to die and to be persecuted for our sins. Verse 8, by oppression and judgment he was taken away. And who can speak of his descendants? He was cut off from the land of the living. He died for us. For the transgression of my people, he was stricken. He was assigned a grave with the wicked. He died with thieves and with the rich in his death. It told us about way back when that he was buried in Joseph of Arimathea, a rich man's tomb. Though he had done no violence, nor there was any deceit in his mouth, Jesus was sinless. Yet it was the Lord's will to crush him and to cause him to suffer. And though the Lord makes his life a guilt offering, he will see his offspring prolong his days. And the will of the Lord will prosper in his hand. After the suffering of his soul, he will see the light of life and be satisfied by his knowledge. My righteous servant will justify many, and he will bear their iniquities. In the book of Isaiah, it said that Jesus would live among us. It said that he would die, be afflicted, be tortured, die, and take our punishment. And by his death, we would be healed and we would have life. It was God's plan from the beginning. He knew what was coming, and he endured it all for our salvation. It was God's plan. Easter is not only God's plan, Easter was and is God's proof. If there were doubts before his death and resurrection, there should be no more doubts. The disciples were transformed after his resurrection from frightened, defeated, lost souls hiding behind locked doors to bold, undefeated evangelists for Christ. Now, how could this be? How could this transformation take place? Well, it took place, Paul lays out in verses 5 through 8, as he talked about all the people that Jesus appeared to. In verse 5, it says he appeared to Peter. He appeared to the 12. In verse 6, he says he appeared to 500 at one time. And at this time of the writing, many of them were still living. In verse 7, it says he appeared to James. That's the brother of Jesus. And it tells us in the Bible that he also appeared to some of his other brothers. In Acts chapter 1, verse 14, it talks about his brothers being in the upper room waiting for the Holy Spirit to come. And you know why they were there? They were there because Jesus went and saw them. Why? Because the last experience we had in the New Testament was they were going to Jesus saying, "You're crazy. You need to come home." Something happened. What happened is Jesus went to visit them after he rose from the grave. It says he visited all the apostles. And in verse 8, Paul says he visited me, one abnormally born. Now, what did that mean? That means that Jesus came back and visited him after the 40 days that Jesus spent here on this earth and then rose from the grave. And you know, I love the resurrection stories, don't you? The resurrection stories are just great. In fact, some of my favorite ones are the one of the early morning believers, Mary Magdalene. She was an early morning person. She and the other Marys got up early before dawn and went to anoint the body of Jesus. When they got there, the stone was rolled away. And in John chapter 20, it tells us they panicked. So they ran and they got Peter and John and they said, "The stone is rolled away and you know, he's not there." And so they ran back up there. And it says that Peter and John got there and Peter rushed in. And then John finally stuck his head in and they saw he was no longer there, and it said John believed. They left and went back, and then Mary came back again, and what she finds, she found an angel. Angel said, "He's not here." And then she heard a voice from behind her saying, "Mary," and she knew it was Jesus. She saw him, and Jesus told him to go tell his disciples, tell them you have seen the Lord. And I love the story in Luke 24. Two disciples discouraged, leaving Jerusalem and going back to their home in Emmaus, walking the 7 miles from Jerusalem to Emmaus. They run into a stranger, and they're surprised to find out he doesn't know anything about Jesus. And they said, "We're just all sad. He's gone, and we thought he might be the Messiah." And then he says, "You don't understand anything, do you?" And he begins to give them a Bible study, and he goes all the way through the Bible pointing to Jesus here and there and here and there, showing that Jesus had to come, Jesus had to be crucified, Jesus had to die, and yes, Jesus would rise. And then they're so intrigued by this man, they say, "Come and eat supper with us." And he breaks bread, and suddenly they realize they've been walking with Jesus the whole time, and he just goes away. And they run back the 7 miles. They'd stumbled back 7 miles home, and they ran back 7 miles to Jerusalem. They got the disciples going to tell them something excited no one has seen, and what they tell them, "We've all seen Jesus too." And then I love most of all that story in John chapter 21. The disciples, not knowing quite what to do now, Jesus has risen from the grave. So what does fishermen do? They go fishing. They get their boat and they fish. And just like me, this is my experience of fishing. They fish all night and they catch what? Nothing. They catch all night. And the last thing you want to hear from shore is some old man going, "Hey, if you just turn over your boat over that way, you'll find all kinds of fish." And so they do. And fish start popping in the boat. And all of a sudden, Peter goes, "I think I've heard this story before." And he looks over the shore and there's Jesus. And he dives in. And what happens? They get to shore and they have the first brotherhood breakfast. Jesus has food there waiting for them. They sit around and they eat. They eat together. And then Peter has a personal conversation with Jesus, and they get past this thing of him denying him 3 times and reset and forgive his life. Do you think they believe Jesus is alive? Everywhere they turn, there's Jesus. And then 500 at one time gather, 500. Then they watch him descend up to heaven. That's how they became those bold disciples. There was no doubt in their mind Jesus was alive. Jesus was there. Now, some have said they made it all up. They made it all up. Nonsense. I was reading Charles Colson the other day, reading a quote from his. Charles Colson was a guy that got embroiled in Watergate years and years ago, and he ended up spending some time in prison, and he got saved, and he came to know the Lord, and he ended up ministering to prisoners. But he was talking about the resurrection, and listen to what he said. He said, "I know the resurrection is a fact." And he says, "How do I know that?" "And Watergate proved it to me." "Why?" He says, "How?" "Because 12 men testified that they had seen Jesus raised from the dead. Then they proclaimed that truth for 40 years, never once denying it. Everyone was beaten, tortured, stoned, and put in prison. They would not have endured that if it were not true." He said Watergate was embroiled with 12 of the most powerful men in the world, and they couldn't keep alive for 3 weeks. You're telling me 12 apostles could keep alive for 40 years? Absolutely impossible. They were transformed. It was God's proof. Now, some would say, does it really matter? Does it matter? It does. If you read on in 1 Corinthians 15, Paul says, if it's not true, then he says in verse 15, I'm a false witness. If it's not true, then the dead are not raised to new life. If it's not true, verse 17 says, you are still in your sins. You still sound condemned, stand condemned. In verse 18, it says, those who've fallen asleep, they're lost. You'll never see them again. If it's not true, verse 19 says, we are to be pitied more than all men. But he starts out verse 20 with one word, but. But Christ has indeed been raised from the dead. It is a sure thing. You could be more sure of this than anything else in your life because Easter is real. It is true. And in Easter, we have God's riches. We have God's riches. In 1 Corinthians 15, verses 20 through 22, it says, but Christ has indeed been raised from the dead, the first fruits of those who have fallen asleep. For since death came through a man, then resurrection of the dead came through a man. And for of all in Adam all die, then so in Christ all are made alive. More sure than that lightning is Jesus rose from the dead. In Adam we had death, but in Christ we have life, eternal life, but we have much more. In fact, Jesus tells us we are the first fruits. That means that what Jesus had and became, we can become. Jesus was given a new body, and someday we'll be given a new body. He was brought to life, and we know eternal life right here and now. You know one of the great things I love in this passage? Paul talks about himself in verses 9 and 10, and he says, his grace to me was not without effect. It was not without effect. Paul said, look at me. When I came to know Jesus, I became different. I used to be a hate-filled murderer. I stood around and I cheered when they killed Stephen. I went and pleaded for the opportunity to imprison and to injure and to ruin the lives of Christians. But when I found Jesus, I became the apostle of love. And I laid down my life so others could know Jesus. It was not without effect. And you know, when you come to know Jesus, his grace is not without effect in your life. It transforms you. It gives you hope. It gives you a new beginning. It changes you. Whatever you are now, you don't have to be that. His grace can make you something different and can make you something more. Now, some of us might say, what do I need to do with it? Well, there's two things you need to do. One, you need to receive it. And some of you might be sitting here today and you've never received God's gift of eternal life. In Romans chapter 10, verses 9 and 10, it simply tells us this. It tells us that if you confess with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you shall be saved. For it's with your heart that you believe and are justified. It's with your mouth that you confess or saved. If you simply call to the Lord, admit that you're a sinner, ask him to forgive you, and ask him to be the Lord of your life, the Bible says you'll be saved. All you have to do is reach out and do that. I did that when I was 14 years old. God entered my life. I knew a difference from the moment I received him to the moment of now, and I know he'll be with me forever. If you've not made that choice, you need to do it. And if you've made that choice, and you know what you need to do? You need to proclaim it. In Acts 1:8, before Jesus left, he said, all of us who received him were his what? Were his witnesses. And we need to share the good news. But some of you say, well, everybody already knows the good news. Who do I need to share it with? And you know what? That's the biggest lie ever told. You don't know that. There are people all around you that don't know the truth. They don't understand it. In fact, in the book of Corinthians, it also says, we're in his ambassadors, and Christ is doing what through us? Appealing, pleading. He wants us to do that for others. It's not enough to assume or to let everybody go their own way. God doesn't want everybody to go their own way. He wants them to come to him. He wants us to plead with him, to tell them the good news. And the truth is, most people don't understand. Even here in the Bible Belt, people in New York, we know nobody understands there. And I want to give you a simple illustration. In John chapter 10, verse 9, Jesus said, I am the gate. And if you enter through the gate, you'll enter and find life. He says, I am the gate. Okay? Let me tell you a brief story. We'll end with this. Over the years, I've been pastor here for a long time. And when I first came to be pastor here, they had a service that mowed my lawn. And so I would come, and somebody would every now and then come and mow my lawn. After we'd been here a couple of years, money got a little tight, and I said, well, you know, I kind of like mowing my lawn, so you can take that off, and I'll do it myself. It's exercise. I like it. I may be a weirdo, but I like to mow my lawn. It's just fun to do. And so I've done it ever since. For over a quarter of a century, I have mowed my own lawn all the time. I like it. And so that's how long I've done it. But before that fella finished mowing my lawn, one of the things he did, one of the last times he did it, is he broke my fence, or the church's fence where I live. And there's a gate, a big gate and a small gate. And he came along with his riding mower as he's flying through, and he broke the gate. And we've always had dogs, always had puppy dogs, and most of them, unlike Bentley, have lived in the backyard. And so he broke the gate, and so it wouldn't close. And so he just went on. And so I called him up and said, you know, you kind of need to fix my fence because I don't know how to fix it. And so he was going to hire anybody to fix it. So he came with a blowtorch, and he came and he fixed the fence. Now, when he fixed the fence, what that means is it was shut, but it was still broken. You couldn't open it. Now, over the years, I jimmy-rigged and got the big fence. It's kind of a big thing where you can get a car through. But the little gate there had never been opened, ever, never once. Now, I had another gate on the other side of the yard, all the way in the other side of the yard. And so whenever I mowed or hadn't gone to the backyard, I would walk all the way around to the side. And so I would go there. And so for 25 years, every time I took my lawnmower, I'd take it in that side. Never taught the dog, it went inside. And so that gate wouldn't open. And it just wouldn't open. You just couldn't open. No, it wasn't humanly possible. And I didn't care as long as it kept the dogs in. Well, over the years, the church folks have been kind whenever I've had big projects to help me out. They've helped clean up some trees, and one time we even tore down an old storage building. And one day, I don't think here right now, but Owen was with me. Owen was with a group that came to help clean up in my house. And so I was standing on this side of the fence. There's a fence, and there's the gate that never is open. And I'm standing there with Owen, and I'm talking to him. And suddenly someone calls to me, and I turn around and talk to him for a second, and I turn back around. And suddenly Owen's not on this side of the fence. He's on the other side of the fence. And so immediately in my mind, Owen's a whole lot more nimble than I thought he was, because somehow he has gotten from this side of the fence to the other side of the fence, and that's impossible. And so I asked him a question that he must have thought I was crazy. I said, "How did you do that? And how did you do that?" And so he kind of stared at me for a minute, and then he walked over and he lifted up the little latch and he opened the gate. Sometime in the years when somebody's been over there, they fix my gate. You know what? I never knew it. For years, I went to that gate and never went through that gate. Why? That gate won't open. That gate won't open. Now, I want you to tell somebody. Jesus says, "I am the gate." There are people all around you. They've gone to that gate before, to get to a better life, to get to something else. And you know what they think in their mind? That gate's not opening. That gate won't open to me. They don't know it will open for them. They just don't know. They need to hear it from you. They need to know that Jesus died for them, that Jesus rose for them, that Jesus loves them, that there's nothing they have done or could ever do that could stop his love and forgiveness and grace in giving them a new life. The gate opens. That's all Jesus asked us to tell people, that I've walked through the gate and you can too. And you know what? When you share people that, there are a whole lot of people will go, "Well, if you can get in, I want to get in too." That's what Easter is about. It's a fresh chance for all of us. And for those of us who have it, it's a chance for us to bring others in. That's all Jesus asked. Will you do it? Let's pray. Dear Lord, we thank you for Easter. We thank you that you loved us so much, you died for us, that you rose for us so that life can be new and life can be with you and life can be fresh. And Lord, you not only gave it to us, but you gave it to us so that we could give it away. And Lord, burn in our hearts the people who need to know Jesus. Don't let us pass another day until we tell them the gate's open and they can come in too. And Lord, if there's anyone here today who needs you as Lord and Savior, let them receive you. Let them walk this aisle and let us pray together and let today be a new day. And anyone who needs to make a new step of faith, speak to their hearts and give them the grace to move forward, Lord. In Christ's name we pray. Amen. If today's a new day for you, you need Jesus, be proud to pray with you. If you'd like to be a part of our fellowship, we'd love to receive you. If you need to take a step of faith, we want to stand with you. Let's stand and sing together our hymn of invitation.
The hymn number is 330, Amazing Grace, 330.
So much for being here today. Thank you, Emily, leading us. Thank you, Robert, for being with us here today so much, and Reborn Harmony, and Clarence, and Mr. Truman. Thank you all for being here today. All right. Hope you have a wonderful Easter. We're going to sing our closing chorus as we go from this place.
It's 533. Our closing hymn is 533, He Lives. Aren't you so glad He Lives?